I don't know. Why does it want to be so difficult? It's not popping up. We'll keep working.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Oh, it's the sunshine out there.
Great.
Right? A February full moon, or January full moon, and now we're in February. We've had a couple days of sunshine. Friday was pretty sunny. I've been here working in the church the past 2 days, getting the office ready right outside of this door. It's already EV. We'll be moving in this week. So we're pretty excited about having them back in the building in our partnership with the Village Association. Our cold gear selection, if you guys haven't seen it, the tree right out here, decorated full of winter clothing for people in need, for the homeless. It's made the news on multiple occasions. I've got phone calls, other churches have followed suit and set up the same type of thing. So it's a success that people get the opportunity to get what they need to stay warm. While living here in Buffalo. On February 26th, we're going to have a congregational meeting after service where we will talk about the past year, the finances, my report on my first year here serving you. Next Sunday is breakfast church. The Boy Scouts will be here making pancakes for us. That means somebody to bring a drink or a dish to pass. We will have a nice prayer, have some food, some breakfast, some fellowship, and then we will proceed into our service. And as always, the blessing box outside, a challenge constantly keeping full as it's emptied as fast as we put food into it. There's a lot of need out there. So if anybody can donate canned goods, pasta, sauce, peanut butter, those seem to be soup. That seems to be the things that go the fastest. So keep that in mind when you're grocery shopping. I think that's it. So with that, how about we worship God? Please stand and join me in our call to worship. It's printed in our book. Steady our steps, O God, as we travel the journey set before us.
Let us walk in the way of light and pursue the path of peace.
Lord, keep us on your course of life as we seek to be faithful.
As we gather to
praise
you, our faithful Lord and God.
Amen. Our first hymn today is "What a Walk as a Child of the Light." It's in our book.
Thank you.
as we have some visitors today, some new attendants, so I'm going to let this be known. As Presbyterian, we confess our sins as a community, as the people of God. We do not confess our sins individually. So in those shadows of isolation, God speaks the word of life to the community. And through God's greatness, through his healing presence, God redeems us, our wonderness, and restores us to fullness. Trusting in God's great provisions, let us now confess our limitations and proclaim God's faithfulness. Please join me in the prayer. Generous God, we are baptized as your people, called to live and serve together as your church. We confess that we have sought to live for ourselves, not reaching out to others, and honoring the divine image in all your children. Forgive us, we pray. In your abundant mercy, give us the grace to be your church, confessing our faults,
offering forgiveness,
and working for reconciliation. Turn our hearts to your intentions, that we may hold fast to one another and draw near to your presence.
In Jesus we ask it. Amen.
Friends, hear that good news. The good news that you have been reconciled to God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Find peace that you have been forgiven. Let us all share the joy of that peace with one another. May the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Friends, let us pray. Gracious God, what the world says and what you say, they're often at odds. This morning, set before us now your truth as we hear your word and as we respond in faithful trust. Amen. Our first reading today comes from the book of Psalms. As you know, as I said many times, Psalms is one of my favorite. The proclamation of every emotion and every feeling, every possible thing we can go through in life is proclaimed in Psalms. And I want to read from chapter 6, verses 2 through 9. Listen now for God's word for you today. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for I am languishing. O Lord, heal me, for my bones are shaking with terror.
My soul is struck with terror. While you, O Lord, how long? Turn, O Lord, save my life. Deliver me for the sake of your steadfast love. For in death there is no remembrance of you. And show, who can give you praise? I'm weary with my mourning. Every night I flood my bed with tears. I drench my couch with my weeping. My eyes waste away because of grief. They grow weak because of my foes. Depart from me, all you workers of evil, for the Lord has heard the sounds of my weeping. The Lord has heard my supplication. The Lord accepts my prayer. Friends, this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our gospel reading today comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 9, verses 18 through 26. While Jesus was saying these things to them, suddenly a leader of the synagogue came in and knelt before him. And he said, "My daughter has just died, but come and lay your hand on her, and she will live." And Jesus got up and followed him with his disciples. Then suddenly a woman who had suffered from her hemorrhages for 12 years came up behind him and touched the fringe of his cloak. For she said to herself, "If only I touch his cloak, I will be made well." Jesus turned, and seeing her, he said, "Take heart, daughter. Your faith has made you well." And instantly the woman was made well. When Jesus came to the leader's house and saw the flute players in the crowd making a commotion, he said to them, "Go away, for this girl is not dead, but she is only sleeping." And they laughed at him. But when the crowd had been put outside, he went in and he took her by the hand, and the girl got up. And the report of this spread throughout the nation. Friends, the word of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Now, being Healing Sunday, this is the second Healing Sunday we've had since I've been here. And I have to admit, I struggled. I struggled last month in Healing Sunday. I preached on what we need to do to get healing, what we need to pray, our faith, and how all that comes into play as it pertains to us. And I didn't know where to go. This probably will be the last sermon on healing for these Healing Sundays, being every month now that we're going to have one of these, finding things to preach about on healing. This sermon has exhausted my resources. But this sermon is very real. It's about what I have experienced through my healing, through my road, my path to get to where I'm at right now. And what I have found is this. God wants to heal every aspect of our being. He wants to heal our heart, our soul, our body, our mind, and our spirit. And he wants the redeemed to pray for their healing as an act of trust and dependence on him. And to know where our ultimate source of healing comes from. While some aspects of our being are healed immediately during our prayer, others, God heals over time as a way of transforming us into the likeness of Christ. You see, when we're sick and we go see a doctor may tell you that healing is a result of medical science. That is true. But we have to realize that God works through those doctors. He gives them the wisdom, the talents, to heal us. A A nutritionalist may tell us that healing is a result of natural supplements. But what we need to know is God provides those healing agents. Those things we find in nature that work through Him. We have to realize that God does heal through the power of prayer. We've all heard cases of miracles. Maybe we've experienced them. When a tumor is clearly on an MRI, and after much prayer, a second, a third scan, it shows that the tumor is now gone. There is no explanation for this. We can only have faith in God's healing hand. I have also seen God's work through a combination of medical treatments, natural remedies, and the prayers of His people. As we read in Matthew, Jesus once told a woman who risked everything to touch Him. He told her, "Your faith has made you well." Friends, as you exercise diligence to do what you can do to be healthy, we must have faith. We must have faith that He can heal our physical infirmities. Today, tomorrow, we don't know. But that's what faith is all about, right? Although God is able to heal any physical ailment we have, He sometimes allows us to endure certain ailments. Because when we endure, when we suffer, they cause us to depend more fully on Him. They draw us closer to Him. Closer than we've ever been before. Our prayers become more steady, more heartfelt, more real. And whether God chooses to heal us physically or not, we are to maintain that trust in Him, that trust that He is good, and that nothing touches our bodies that hasn't first passed through Him. See, we can invite Jesus into our lives, and we can claim the gift of eternal life and call ourselves His children, but there always will be disease. And some of this disease doesn't have to be physical. Some of this disease can be of self. Because even after the disease of sin has been atoned for, we are told by the Apostle Paul that we know that nothing good dwells in us. That is, in our flesh, the willing is present, but the doing of good is not always present. And that can bring us down, knowing that sin is always present, that sickness is always present. But Paul also gives us hope. Hope for the constant battle rooted in our flesh. Because Paul tells us that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ. In other words, self-discipline, determination, trying harder, or masking ourselves in good works, don't always fly as much as faith. So thanks be to God. Thanks be to God that Jesus is the only one who can cure us of disease of self. Because when we die to self and we live into Him, we are healed. Paul also told us that the key to healing the disease of self, Paul also told us about the key to healing the disease of self. is this. Once you have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer who I live, but it is that Christ lives in you. And that the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself up for me. So what he's saying is we can't live for ourselves. We can't be greedy and always wanting the best for ourselves. But we have to want the best for what we feel, for what we believe, for the faith we have in our Creator. This is why faith is so vital. Because through that faith, we die to ourselves. So God can finally heal us of our disease, that disease of pride and of self that I spoke about. That's a hard question, to have so much faith that we let ourselves die and take on a different existence in God. It's a hard question. And it's a hard task to fulfill. But I got to tell you, through my own experiences, it was the only way I healed. The only way I got to this place in my life of complete happiness. Stress-free, I have been healed. We suffer a lot of things as humans. Sometimes we experience emotional wounds, and they can be deeper and more painful than physical injuries or illnesses. We experience the absence of parental love, the pain of rejection, betrayal. Some experience the worst, the emotional horror of rape, or the unexplained sorrow of losing a child, losing a spouse, losing anybody you deeply care about. It all can seem incurable. And it feels this way because God never designed us to experience that kind of grief and sorrow. I got to tell you, we were made to love God and enjoy Him forever in a sinless and disease-free paradise in His garden. Yet in that same garden, we inherited sin from the transgressions of Adam. It ushered in pain and heartache that still can feel foreign to the kind of life we are designed to live. But again, have faith, because Jesus heals those kinds of wounds. Those kinds of wounds that can't be cured by surgery, by medication, or even by a positive attitude. I turn back to the Psalms where it says, He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. And in Hebrews, Paul tells us, for we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses. But we have one who has been tempted in all things we are. Therefore, we have to draw near with confidence to the throne of grace, so that we may be received in that mercy, that we can find the grace to help us in our times of need. Because that high priest is Jesus. Because He has surely borne our griefs, and He's carried out our sorrows. He has experienced all that we have ever endured. In our times of temptation, in our times of sorrow, in our times of pain, and everything else, He has overcome it already for us. And He's here to help us bear it and overcome it. ask you, have you surrendered your emotional baggage to Jesus? Another hard question. Everything that we feel, everything we struggle with, it's hard to lay it out there. Not suppress it. But it's the only way to heal. It's been said that time heals all wounds. I believe that. But I only believe that happens when we give our wounds to God. And we trust that He can heal them. But it's going to be in His time. We know that raw, open wounds, they don't heal overnight. But if we cultivate a lifestyle of trusting God, a lifestyle of forgiving others, a lifestyle of walking in the light, a lifestyle of clinging to His words, He will heal us of those wounds. Those ones that we can't seem to overcome on our own. The ones that reoccur time and time again in our lives. Maybe you aren't holding on to an offense by someone else. Maybe you're holding on to something that you did. Something that you cannot forgive yourself for. This is true in my case. And the only way I have healed from that is trust. Trust that if God can forgive me, I must forgive myself also. I had to realize that I was the exception. Because He told me in Scripture, as far as the east is from the west, this is how far I have removed you from your own transgressions. Don't ever think that you're excluded from His generous offer. If anyone is in Christ, they are a new creature, a new creation. And you can behold all those new things that have come. I ask you, please let Him heal you of whatever is in your past. Because He is a God of fresh starts and new beginnings. You may find yourself experiencing a problem, maybe with loving someone or forgiving someone. Moving on past a certain hurt because your mind keeps replaying it. God is the only one who can take care of this completely. We are told in Romans not to be conformed to the world and its way of thinking and behaving, but to be transformed by the renewing of our minds so we can discern the good and be acceptable, and be the perfect will of God. It all comes back to dying to ourselves, letting go of all those feelings, those transgressions, those guilts. Because once our heart is healthy, our body is healthy. Because the heart is where He lies. The heart is where we lie. Our true feelings lie there. And when that is healed, when that is complete, it allows God to renew our minds, our thinking. And we do this through the constant reading and study of Scripture. We do this with coming together as a community, enjoying the company of others, others who also obey his word. But we also have to possess a continual yielding to the direction and the conviction of evil. And we do this with the Holy Spirit that the Lord has so freely offered. This morning I will offer you the opportunity to come forward to rejuvenate that Holy Spirit that works within you. He'll be offering you the opportunity to be anointed with oil as a symbol of God's grace, a symbol of his love, a symbol of the healing power through that Spirit. Because in that, friends, we will realize that God is the greatest doctor of all time. So let us follow Christ. Let us surrender. Let us die to ourselves and let the healing begin. Amen. So I'm going to push this aside and invite anybody who would like to come forward.
God of grace
and steadfast love, we thank you for our Lord and all that we share in this community. We thank you for the calling us to ministries of hope and compassion. We pray for your grace to do all that you ask of us. You ask us to choose life, to love you, to love our neighbors without reserve, not half-hearted, but with our whole selves. Holy God, we bring before you our cares, our concerns, and the joys that occupy us. We remember before you those who are at odds with one another, in families, in neighborhoods, in offices, in communities, and in the church across the political aisles, and in deep-seated divisions. We pray for the nations in the midst of eternal and external conflicts, and all those who suffer because of these conflicts, because of the violence and terror of war. We pray for the people of Ukraine. We pray for the people of Russia. We remember today before you those who have physical needs, people who fear for their safety, people who fear for their well-being, people who are hungry, people who are thirsty. We remember people who are exhausted by the demands of work, by the demands of caregiving. We bring before you people who are sick or who undergo surgery, and people who live with chronic pain. Lord, bring relief and rest, we pray. Today we remember those weighed down with needs of heart and soul, a worry that keeps us awake at night, grief that accompanies us everywhere as we go. We remember depression that clouds us, or addiction that grips us. We remember those who we love, those who lift all the heavy burdens with the light and the peace of your presence, we pray. Lord, sustain us over the long journey towards health and wholeness, and give us trust in you, trust in ourselves, and trust in those who love us to be there with us. We remember before you not only our cares, but also our joys, all the things that are life-giving, a birthday celebration, an anniversary enjoyed, a baby born, a new life with a spouse, a new job, a new relationship, a new day of miracles. But we also have to remember and pray with heavy hearts, the people of Turkey and Syria. There is no time greater than this that you be with those who are suffering, those who have lost everything. Lord, we give thanks that you are always with us, always providing us a new beginning, a way where there is no way, hope where there is no hope, and life beyond God. Give us the courage to trust you as we choose your life-giving path. Pray. As our Lord Jesus Christ taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, God's word finds fertile ground each and every time we choose life. Each time we share the gifts of God's grace and love. So let us now gather our gifts together and offer them to God in gratitude and praise. Gracious God, you have planted the seeds of generosity into our hearts. And by your grace, you give the growth through our actions in response. God, receive the fruit of your mercy and the offerings of our lives, and use these gifts to grow your harvest of justice and mercy. Amen. Our closing hymn today is O Christ the Healer. In our book.
Thank you.
Brothers and sisters, we see what is set before us. Life, death, God's ways and our ways, blessings and cursing. And in our response to God's mercy, we should choose life, embrace life, offer life, rejoice in life, trusting in the one who longs to bless us with life through the love of God, and through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and through the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. May you go with blessings. Amen.
That's right, we have to get the confirmation. They want to say that. Take a moment, bring Leah back to confirmation.